So hello everyone, my name is Olli Rantanen and I work as an IT specialist in the National Land Survey of Finland. And I'm here to tell you about our project of developing a QGIS-based topographic data management system. A bit about the background, for the presentation contents. First I'm going to tell you a little bit about the background of the project, then goals for the development, the system architecture, some of the developed components we have done, also a demo video, and some published components. So for the topographic data production in NLS, so we have two processes to collect topographic data. The first being periodical updating process, which is based on the aerial photography of a target area. In this, operators edit topographic data with stereo mapping, and this also includes some field mapping. This process is then repeated for the same areas in these three-year intervals, and we also take aerial images of these same areas on this same three-year interval, covering almost the whole of Finland in this time. Then we have the continuous updating process, which is used more for the more essential teams like buildings and road links and so forth for Gitsong and the topographic database. So these are updated more continuously, like whenever we get information about them from municipalities, other governmental agencies, or customer feedback, etc. Then for the stereo mapping, maybe some of you don't or haven't seen one, but this is stereo desktop on the image there, and it's the main way for us to collect the topographic data. It holds an accurate representation of objects in 3D stereo view, and then allows more precise mapping than 2D or the photos. And you indeed need that stereo desktop and also stereo glasses to see the objects in 3D. We have also implemented new national data models. They have these like five different categories for different teams or data teams. The first one being buildings and constructions, terrain, hydrography, traffic, network special conservation areas, and also administrative boundaries. And there's over 100 separate feature layers with these topological relations. Then for the roadmap, so we started this project in 2021, and we are planning to get to the end or the deployment on 2025. So the idea is to replace the current topographic data management system, creating tools for topographic data collection, also the field mapping there, and also integrating into our current product platforms. For the phase two and three, these still don't have a year yet, but our plan is to have new data and map products then, collecting the data according to those new data models, and then having a QGIS-based place name register. For the phase three, we plan to have new management and generalization processes for map data, and some plans for QGIS-based digital elevation model production. For the goals for the phase one, as separate requirements, so the first one are first saying that the blue ones are the ones we have done now, and the red ones are the ones we are still working on. So the first one being the concurrent data management by 100 operators, meaning that 100 mappers edit the same dataset or the topographic database. And then the blue, next red one is the efficient editing of topographic data, having the tools for the operators to efficiently edit the data. Then enabling the stereo mapping, so creating a API for ESPA City, which is our stereo mapping software, which communicates with the QGIS or our system. Then implementing those new national data models, which I showed you before. Having new quality assurance tools for the operator. Derivating the feature heights. Having data available for our own processes and the product platforms. And also implementing field mapping to our system. And that's actually a cool field we are trying to implement there. For the system architecture then, so the whole idea kind of revolves around the idea of having 100 operators editing the same data set. So on the left-hand corner there, you can see the primary database plus version history. And you can use Job Manager service to access this primary database to get a work database for all the operators. So kind of you create your own selected area from the primary database for a work database. And then you edit that data via QGIS and the stereo mapping software. When you create those edits, you can then push them to the primary database via this service. Focusing then on the quality assurance tool, which Andra told you about, Peter. So, yeah, focusing on the logical consistency of the data, the developed tool, and it's based on quality rules. These quality rules revolve around geometry attribute and topological rules, and also continuity of attributes like networks and road links. This production of work is then quieted by these severity levels of these errors. And currently, we have info, warning, and fatal states. The idea is that we could have different limits for the data. For example, fatal ones can't be updated to the primary database. Then QGIS does indeed provide some tools for this quality checking, but we created a custom solution to provide more comprehensive inspection for the data, both in work and primary database. It also has the best performance with the database, and it runs in the background, meaning that the operator doesn't have to do their own runs for the data quality checks. And that we also have only one place to manage the rules. So on the picture there, you can see the developed tool, but maybe on the demo video, you will see it a bit better. The operator can always access these quality rules results at any time during the workflow, and the results are refreshed each time the operator saves the modifications. On the picture there, you see those objects with a halo effect, and those are the ones which have the errors. The operator can access any of the quality rules or the errors there, and then they can fix them, and they will drop from the list when they save the edits there. The operator can also filter through these quality results by just focusing on some warning state having errors, or maybe the ones with only the fatal ones. For the developed components, for the editing purposes, we have made a plugin to select an active layer from map, because there's those 100 feature classes. It can be a bit troublesome to find it from the list. Then we have made an editing mode and saving for all layers. Then also a topological segment reshape tool, which Antero mentioned in a previous talk. Then visualization of earlier changes, so having the option to access the earlier versions of features. For example, if you want to check if the attributes has been something different from before or the geometry has changed. We still have ongoing developments for the editing and helping the operator, so to speak. So the first one being the search from multiple layers in primary and work database. And we plan to have it implemented on maybe autumn. And then street address management tools, so tools for managing those addresses for road links. For example, if an operator cuts a road link, then they can still have flowing addresses on the road links, and they don't have to worry about these operations. We also need an easy way to provide additional datasets to all users efficiently. Okay, the next one is the demo video, maybe a bit of whatever. All right. Yeah, so that's a map of Finland, and I'm just zooming here to show you how the modification areas look on the map. So you can see that there's an actual person doing something there. And I'm actually zooming in to my favorite vacation spot in Vuokatti, which has a perfect golf course, by the way, if there's any golfers here. Let's see if I get to zoom there. And yeah, now we are seeing the primary database loading up all the objects. So before it was just raster map. And as you can see, it's a ton of data there that needs to be shown all the time. And we actually had a slower environment than usually when I took this video, but maybe it doesn't matter here. So yeah, I'm trying to find a spot I could create my own work area. So creating a new job. It first creates those layers, so basically a copy of the primary there. So we have all the working layers there for the topographic database. I'm just showing you, it's an empty attribute table at the moment because I still need to extend the modification area. And that's the moment where I get actually all the features. So yeah, when I'm opening it up, I can actually see something there. Perfect. And that's how it looks on the map. For the next user who would come to the area, they would see that I have a registration area here. Yeah, and next I will probably open up boulders in water. So I know that boulders in water should probably be on water. So I'm creating one after opening up the quality tool to see that there's zero errors on this particular area, but I'm creating one now. So yeah, there should be boulders in water on top of a golf course, probably. And saving that up. And then just creating another one on the lake there, because that shouldn't be an error. There can be, of course, boulders in water there. And when I save, I can see the error list updating in a few seconds. Yeah, so now I got the error there saying that this geometry should be on top of or must be covered by lakes, seas, or watercourse parts. And yeah, so yeah, I'm making another one on the left side there, because it could be also that it shouldn't be on top of a golf course. This is just inland, the same thing over again. And saving up and getting the same results there. And I can go ahead and delete those objects which have the errors on them. All right. Yeah, saving all the edits. Yeah, then my plan is to expand the modification area a bit, so you get to see like that it's quite fast with running the quality run again for the new area. And as you can see, there's quite a lot of data there, so should be at least a couple mistakes as well. Yeah, and it takes a while to extend the modification area. Depends on the size of the area. And it says that the quality check is in progress still, but pretty fastly it got new results for different features which have errors. And this was actually from the real topographic database, so there is a building on top of a cultivated land or field. And yeah, I used the pick layer tool to select the active layer again as the cultivated lands. And I can easily modify it, like from the vertices, for example, to actually like align with the building there. And yeah, and I have two errors there for this particular object. But when I save, I get two of them gone, since we have them working on both ways for certain objects. For cultivated lands, they can't be on top of buildings or buildings on top of cultivated lands. Yeah, and I can go ahead and register these changes. And now they are pushed to the primary database. And the next user can see this registration area that I have made this registration. Maybe it, they can plan on their work based on that, for example. And I'm opening up a new session for like a different user to go to the same area. And yeah, we had a slow environment, so that's why it doesn't show straight away that modification area there that I just made. But as another user, I can still zoom in and see that there's some kind of changes like that boulders in water I just made there on the top. And I'm trying to find the building, but I can't find it apparently. Yeah, but now it popped out like the modification area. So yeah, that's like the demo, how it works in a typical workflow. Just going through the tools we have published. So first, for the open source development tools, we have published QGIS plugin development and packaging tools. Then just mentioning the Hispo coding made PyTest plugin for testing plugins, because we have contributed quite a bit for that. Then the editing tools for pick layer, that's one. Then the topological segment reshape tool that Antero mentioned in the previous talk. Then for the quality checker there, or quality tool, we have the plugin for visualizing these quality checks results, and also the database data quality checker. It's the service to execute these quality rules for spatial objects in a database and produce a result JSON. And this also includes some quality rules and some example data set. And that's the same golf course I showed you there, so it's nice. Okay, thank you guys.
Thank you. It's time for questions.
The hashed buffer when someone is doing active edits is really cool. Could you share us some details, maybe how it's technically made?
Maybe Antero could explain the technical. He's the developer of ours, but you mean the buffer for the...
Yes.
Oh yeah, I can't show it on the GIF, but...
Is it like a trigger on the database, and it shows it on a separate map layer?
Yeah, so the quality results then are updated as a like specific layer for the for isn't like temporary layer or something for the quality results that they are showing there. So when you click it, it loads this temporary layer for those, and it displays the visualization.
Okay.
Any more questions? Antero, do you want to comment something? No.
Sorry for pushing you there.
Okay. How do you push data into production? I think there was a button, but...
Yeah, so at the end there, I did the registration. So before that, I did like saving for when the quality tool run. I only saved to the work database. That's still not on the primary, but when I do register the changes, what I did on the end, then it ends up to the primary database. So you kind of can always access the work database. Usually our operators do like 4 hours before registering changes. So they might only do that a couple times a day. So they can always access it, like the work database, from the last edit.
Maybe I didn't see it well, but were there like a user profile to change the from work to this production?
It doesn't. When you log into this environment, which is on Citrix, it detects that I am Olli Rantanen, I'm doing this work.
Okay.
And when I do those edits, they just push to the primary, and I can also go as another user there, check those edits, and see that it was made by Olli Rantanen,
okay,
like before.
So, we have time for questions. And if there's not any questions, then we can go to the lunch and say thank you to Olli.
Thank you, guys.